sounding of the sirens, I would ask you all to please join me in a moment of silence for our fallen. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, distinguished guests, I welcome you all here to our Veterans Day program. My name is Fred Jones, and I'm the proud commander of the American Legion Post 465 here in Jarman. I would like to introduce to you Mr. Nicholas Mattice, a World War II veteran, to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Next on our program, ladies and gentlemen, we have the national anthem sung by Mrs. Christine McGeechee.
Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the
much, Christine. That was very beautiful. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure and it is an honor to introduce to you our guest speaker for today. His name is Earl Granville, and he served 9 years in the Army National Guard in the infantry with deployments to Bosnia, Iraq, and Afghanistan. On his final tour, he lost his left leg through the knee as a roadside bomb while on patrol. His teammates, Major Scott Haggerty of Stillwater, Oklahoma, and Specialist Derek Holland of Wind Gap, Pennsylvania, died in the blast. Earl is now pursuing a bachelor's degree in counseling and human services at the University of Scranton and works for many nonprofits such as Operation Enduring Warrior, the Oscar Mike Foundation, and Warrior Strong. These charities help to keep the wounded and disabled veterans and law enforcement physically active after their injuries. Earl is now retired out of the Army as a staff sergeant with many awards, such as the Combat Infantryman Badge and the Purple Heart. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great honor to introduce to you Staff Sergeant Earl Granville.
Morning, German. How are you?
Good morning.
Hey, can you guys hear me without this? You guys good? Guys, how you doing today? My name is Earl Granville. Like mentioned, I'm a 9-year veteran in the Pennsylvania Army National Guard with tours of Bosnia, Iraq, and Afghanistan. A little bit of what I do now. I work for charities, as mentioned, Operation Enduring Warrior, the Oscar Mike Foundation, and locally here, Warrior Strong. We love to keep our wounded and disabled veterans active, not let their injuries define who they are, and what I feel is most important, be a part of something bigger than yourself, just like when you wore that uniform. I'm a senior at the University of Scranton for Counseling and Human Services, and I play sled hockey for an all-wounded veteran team called the USA Warriors. We're located in Washington, D.C., and ladies and gentlemen, I am the worst sled hockey player you will ever meet. I want to back up a little bit, tell you my reason to join in the military. I was a senior in Carbondale area just down the road here, and my twin brother Joe talked to me about maybe joining the armed forces. And I could say my attitude, being 17 years old at that time, I was like, dude, this is not for me. No way, man. I had no desire to serve my country. That was my attitude at the time and where I was at in that age, okay? But there was an incentive of free college. Basically, I was making it about me. What can I get out of this? Hey, free college, you know what? I'll serve my country for free college. You know, I was making it about me. What can I get out of this? Joe and I graduated high school, had a nice summer, landed at Fort Benning, Georgia for basic training September 1st, 2001. You all know what happened 11 days later, right? When I was down there in Fort Benning with my brother, I looked at him and I said, dude, what did you get me into? I didn't join the military to go to war, right? Yeah, sounds ridiculous, right? As I say it now, it does sound pretty ridiculous. But that's my attitude at the time and who I was. Moving forward, we graduated basic training, being that we're National Guard. We came home after boot camp and I was looking into colleges, but that had to wait. We got orders for Bosnia. The time we went to Bosnia, it was 2002, and pretty much all the fighting and all the heavy stuff has pretty much been done at that time. Our job over there was peacekeeping, and there was really no threat to us and other NATO forces over there. Nice, easy deployment. If you ever want to understand why we were in Bosnia and the rest of NATO forces, read the book, Love Thy Neighbor by Peter Maas. Very powerful book. Understand why we were there. Came home from Bosnia. I enrolled in a Lackawanna College. I got 2 semesters in when we got another warning order. This one was Iraq. It was a volunteer mission, so I was like, dude, I'm gonna stay back if I don't have to go. Right. Well, Joe, on the other hand, he was gonna go. And I had a little while to think about it, a few weeks, so I thought, you know what, man? I guess I'm gonna go with you. God forbid if something happened to you over there while I'm home here partying at college. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the best decision I have ever made. What do I mean by that? Like I said before, I may join the military all about me. What can I get out of this? What can this do for me? But becoming a sergeant over there, an NCO, having more responsibilities and the dangerous situations we were in, I knew this isn't about me. It's about us. And wearing that uniform, I took a lot of pride in. I knew this is a job I wanted to do for the rest of my life, serving my country and my comrades around me. We had some heavy times over there, don't get me wrong. As our unit, the 109th Infantry, was split in half, the half unit I was a part of was in Al Asad, Iraq, where my brothers-in-arms were in Ramadi, and they had some heavy times over there. First, it was August of 2005. Staff Sergeant Ryan Ostrom got hit with sniper fire, killed in action. Then Specialist Billy Evans, the Bradley Fine vehicle he was driving, hit by a roadside bomb, killed in action. September 28th, 5 individuals, the 109th Infantry, all from here in northeastern Pennsylvania, killed in action. White phosphorus ID hit their Bradley fighting vehicle. Gentlemen like Staff Sergeant Puglisi, George Puglisi, Staff Sergeant Daniel Arnold, Sergeant Eric Slobodnik, Specialist Lee Wiegand, and PFC Oliver Brown. Heavy times, ladies and gentlemen. I came home on leave in November. All these flags were still half-mast, and I see their names on businesses everywhere. And the patriotism that this community has brought really felt good inside. So I want to thank you all for that. Moving forward, we came home from Iraq, June of 2006, and I must add, Joe and I both re-upped our contracts while we were over there. I knew this was a job I wanted to do for the rest of my life. When we came home, I enrolled back into Lackawanna College, got my associate's degree, and then we got another warning order, another volunteer mission, and this was Afghanistan. And I knew this job I wanted to do, so I raised my hand. I was like, yeah, I'll go, absolutely. Volunteer mission, sure. Joe, on the other hand, he decided to stay back. He's now married, and him and his wife want to start a family, and he's employed at SCI Waymart as a corrections officer. And he says to me, dude, how about we both go together in the future? How about we both stay back and told when to go again? My responsibility is my family. And I said, sorry, dude, I'm cutting this cord, off I went. On this deployment, 3 months into it, I was escorting civil affairs officers to a site where they were gonna build a school for the Afghans in this little village called Zormont in the Paktia Providence. And this individual I was escorting, his name is Major Scott Haggerty. He liked to be in charge of the vehicle he was in. It's what he did with everybody. It was his MO. So I saw on the roster I was escorting him. I decided to give him my, he took my seat, and I decided to jump in the gunner's hatch. No harm, no foul. I'm not gonna make a big deal out of it. Sure, you could have that shotgun seat, no big deal. June 3rd, 2008, we're leaving the site of this school. We had to take a different route. I'm not gonna get into logistics why, but it was a route we were unfamiliar with. But it was a very beautiful part of Afghanistan where we haven't been before. And I remember going over to the headset and saying to my buddies in the vehicle, man, who's watering their grass in Afghanistan? Look at this beautiful area. It's usually dust and rocks over there. Seeing bright green grass, this is pretty nice. The next thing I remember, ladies and gentlemen, I saw nothing but black. You know when you put your head underwater and, you know, we're going swimming or you're in the bathtub and it's like, or you clog your ears, it's like a faint noise you hear? That's the best way to describe what I was hearing at that time. And I felt the momentum. And I said to myself, what exactly is going on right now in my mind? That's what I'm saying to myself. When I came to, big, beautiful sky. 2:30 in the afternoon, why am I looking at the sky? Oh, jeez, I'm on the ground. My feet are backwards and I'm full of blood. To the left of me, the Humvee is completely destroyed. We just hit a roadside bomb. All I wanted to do was assess the situation at that point. Is anybody else hurt? Are we getting ambushed? I don't even have a working weapon on me to defend myself. I'm completely useless to my friends around me. As my medic got to me, Doc Jones, Tech Sergeant Eric Jones, we called him Doc, he started working on my wounds immediately. He said, Doc, how's everybody else doing? They're doing good, we're gonna get you all out of here. Doc and a few of my other buddies put me on a litter and they carried me to find an MRAP, a bigger vehicle. And when they carried me over, they walked me right past two body bags. That was my comrades, Major Scott Haggerty, the gentleman who took my seat, why I'm still here today to talk to you, and Specialist Derek Holland, like I said, of Wingap, Pennsylvania. Derek just turned 20 years old. Medevac chopper came, took myself and an Afghan governor who's in our back seat. They took us to Bagram Air Base. They worked on my wounds there. Doc said, we have to go under surgery immediately to work on your right hip. Doc, you do what you gotta do. I went under for surgery. The next thing I remember, a nurse was pulling my breathing tube out, and I woke up at Launchdal Air Base in Ramstein, Germany, a whole different part of the world. And I don't remember anything in between. While there, the doctor said, we're gonna have to amputate your left leg through the knee. I can say with confidence, ladies and gentlemen, I felt pretty good. Hey, I'm here today, and that's what matters. I got this second chance. No harm, no foul. Summer of 2008, I finally went back stateside. Walter Reed Army Medical Center in Washington, D.C. This is gonna be my home. And all around us, there's men and women in situations like this. You think of it as like maybe a somber place, careers are coming to an end, lives are altered. But it was the complete opposite. One thing that all these people had is that warrior spirit still. And I gotta tell you, looking back, I realized how important that was in my recovery. And that culture never left of the military. You know, the Army and the Marines are duking out who's a better branch. Nobody likes the Air Force still. But it was so cool to be in that environment. And I'm watching men and women with worse situations than mine achieve their physical goals and the abilities that they have in situations like this. So I realized, boy, this isn't gonna be that bad. Good perspective. I medically retired about a year and a half later. I left Walter Reed and I moved home. And I got a little apartment in DuPont, Pennsylvania. And while I'm home, I'm getting ready for this black tie event a week before Christmas in 2010. I get out of the shower. I put my prosthetic on and my suit pants and a t-shirt before I fully get dressed. I'm doing my hair. My phone rings, I let it go to voicemail. I finish doing my hair, wash the hair gel out. I look at my phone and see it's my mom. She's distraught on the other end and said, "You need to call me immediately." So I give her a call. She picks up the phone, she's crying on the other end, she's so ever somber. "Mom, what's the matter?" "My twin brother, Staff Sergeant Joe Granville, committed suicide on active duty." "Worst day of my life, ladies and gentlemen. How can I get this second chance at life and have my own twin brother take us away at his own hands?" I was crushed. My mindset went right back to making it all about me. Feeling sorry for myself, playing a victim, thinking the world owes me everything. Let me ask you guys something. Where's playing a victim get you in life? What was that? Nowhere. You're absolutely right. I just started to go downhill. Dysfunctional veteran. Do you know what I did for my service? Anybody ever see the movie Napoleon Dynamite? Anybody? You know who Uncle Rico is? That was me. Just living in the past, reminding everybody what I did. There was a turnaround point, ladies and gentlemen, in my life. And it didn't happen overnight. But these charities that we mentioned, that Fred mentioned here, that I work for now, Operation Enduring Warrior, the Oscar Mike Foundation, Warrior Strong, there's tons of them out there. I started serving my country once again in a different form, volunteering my time. And it fulfilled my life so much with purpose. And it made me realize I don't need a uniform to serve my country. I could be a part of something bigger than myself, just like when I wore that uniform. And it really, the joy that I had in this purpose, being a mentor once again for men and women in situations like this, it's like my life was fulfilled. I didn't want my legacy to be the guy who lost his leg in Afghanistan and lost his twin brother. I had to find something more. Looking back, and I realized this is what I needed in my life. Now, in our lives, ladies and gentlemen, I truly believe, veteran or not, we need three P's in our lives. You must have a purpose. You have to develop a passion, and you must be part of something bigger than yourself. Purpose, passion, part of something. And the recipe to find that is good attitude, stepping out of your comfort zone, and community. That's all of you here today, showing your patriotism for our veterans, thanking them for their service, and that pride that comes with it in this nation. And understand, ladies and gentlemen, as human beings, that weight of adversity is gonna get heavier and heavier. Our veterans face it nowadays, losing sight of themselves after they come home, whether it's post-traumatic stress, whether it's what is my purpose now in my life. But as community, we carry that weight of adversity, so nobody has to carry it by themselves. And I got an example to show you that right here. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Cindy the Cinder Block. Somebody's gotta laugh, right? Come on. What Cindy represents, ladies and gentlemen, yeah, I just made that awkward, right? What Cindy represents is the heavy mental adversity that all of us face, veteran, civilian, doesn't matter who you are. The weight of adversity that holds you down, stops you from enjoying life. Guilt, stress, depression, anxiety. All those things that hold you down that makes you not want to move on. Us as human beings, we can figure it out. We got it. We're resilient. But also as human beings, it's easy to get lost. It's easy not to find that path. Where do I go from now? When we take Cindy out in these organizations that I mentioned, we'll run a Spartan race or a 5K, whatever it may be. We'll take this out with us. And after a while, I'll start with it. It gets pretty damn heavy. But I have a team next to me. I'll call him out. My buddy Joey Decker. He lives in Taylor. He works with us. He's a Marine Corps veteran. And I'll go to my buddy Joey. Hey, dude, you want to carry this for a bit? And he'll take it. Or he'll take the brick and I'll run next to him with the chain. The idea is nobody's carrying this alone. That's the same up in here. We don't need a uniform to serve our communities. We don't need a uniform to serve our country. I learned from the military what service is about. And I take a lot of pride in continuing to serve today, just in a different way. And all of us can do that. You don't need combat boots and a rifle to go overseas to serve your men and women here, right here in our backyards, ladies and gentlemen. Understand, nobody has to carry this alone. The struggles we face as a community and a society, it's up to us to see that big picture. Because one thing with these organizations, just like that Iraq deployment, I realized it's not about me and it's not about you. It's about us. You guys tracking?
Yep.
Guys, I'm Earl Granville. Always think of being a vet. To our vets out there, happy Veterans Day. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Sergeant Granville. That was really nice. Ladies and gentlemen, next on our program, we're going to have the Soldier's Prayer as recited by Mr. Dick Muehlheisen, our chaplain.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who has dominion over life and death, grant us to the grace with love and reverence of our valiant and honored departed comrade. Grant peace and eternal rest for those who have gone before us, and make us ready for that last hour. Strengthen and console those in sorrow, and upon us thy everlasting blessing. Amen.
Next on our program, ladies and gentlemen, I will be reading a roll of a call of the Fallen. A list of our fallen warriors from World War I: William J. Griffiths, Carl Baker, Thomas Harvey, Richard Henwood, David Jones, Frank Kelly, George Morgan, Maurice Phillips, James Roach, John Zaleski, Nicholas Selgraf. From World War II, Henry Chelzinski, John Frenchko, Jerome Friedman, Joseph G. Hemack, Donald Kraft, Henry Petrowski, Philip Rippon, Elwin White, Stanley Shishansky, Gerard Hosey, Raymond Rood, Albert Moon, Edward Chirwitz, Andrew Chupp, Walter Tellup, John Mickridge, Alexander Krasinowski, William N. Usher, William Maines. Korean War, Basil Keklak, Joe Socha. Vietnam War, Richard Gary Lewis. Afghanistan, Eric Slobodnik.
Stand by. Prepare to fire. Fire! 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 Order! Fire!
Next on our program, ladies and gentlemen, Amazing Grace, as done by the Lakeland School District Chorus, directed by Mr. Brian Brophy. Thank you to the Lakeland School District Chorus, as directed by Mr. Brian Brophy. Next, we're going to have some remarks from Mrs. Ann Boylan. She's the chairwoman of the German Shade Tree Committee. Mrs. Boylan?
Good morning, everyone, and welcome back. What a beautiful day we have here today to be together to pay tribute to all the veterans who have served us over the decades. On the behalf of the William J. Griffith American Legion Post number 465, the German Shade Tree Commission, and the German Events Committee, we would like to invite you at the conclusion of this program for our traditional luncheon. We have made a few changes, though, than what we have had in the past. For your safety and protection, we have individually wrapped every sandwich, and the desserts are served in their individual containers. For those who are still uncomfortable about being together in a group, we have arranged to have takeouts so that you choose to stay. The tables are set up. If you choose to leave, we have the takeout bags ready for you, and we even have lids for the soup because we don't want anyone to go without Joni Longworth's chicken soup. The other thing I'd like to say is to just please enter at the ramp area of the church basement, and that way there'll be an even flow of traffic. And I want to thank you all for coming, and thank you for supporting our veterans today.
Well done.
Thank you, Ann. Next, we're going to hear from the Lakeland School District Chorus, God Bless America.
They need a microphone.
Thank you.
you to the Lakeland School District Chorus.
Very good, thank you.
In conclusion of our program today, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to again thank Sergeant Earl Granfield for being here and giving us such a very inspirational speech. That concludes our program for today, ladies and gentlemen. And again, thank you so much for being here. Oh, thank you.